Hello, my name is Kenita, and I am a global social media trainer for Jellyfish. So I train businesses all over the world in paid and organic social media strategy. And LinkedIn is one of the platforms that is one of the favorites, actually, when it comes to training at Jellyfish. So I'm going to pass you over to Lara to introduce herself.
I hope you say this in every training. That's a favorite of yours.
Absolutely.
Excellent. My name is Lara Giudio, and I have been with LinkedIn for about 6 years, and I look after our agency and channel education programs. This is the first time we partner with Jellyfish, and I'm very happy about it. And on a Friday afternoon, there we go. And before I pass you back to Kenita, I wanted to share an update. Last year in November, we launched our online self-service training platform called LinkedIn Marketing Labs, and you can access 6 modules in there. And then in June, in July, we are launching our certification program where you can take the exam and get your LinkedIn badge. Some of you on the call might have taken part in our beta. If so, congratulations, being one of the first to be certified. Those who haven't, don't you worry, you don't need to wait long. It's coming very soon.
So in terms of what we're going to go through today, I'm going to do a bit of scene setting and give you an overview of LinkedIn and also what lead gen is. And then I'm going to pass you back over to Lara to talk about the challenges of running lead gen, where there's going to be a poll we're going to ask you to interact with. And then we are going to talk about driving quality leads on LinkedIn, and I'm going to finish off with some inspirational examples. There's about 10 minutes at the end for Q&A. So the webinar will run for around 45 minutes. As mentioned, there is a poll that we're going to ask you to interact with. As we go through the session, feel free to pop any questions that you have in the chat box. So I'll be monitoring this when Lara chats, and so will the events team. You can connect with us here, so feel free to do that now. Also, Lara's been very kind and is willing to give away a couple of premium accounts, and this is going to go to the people that ask the most possibly challenging questions and are engaged throughout the webinar today. So before we start, I just want to give you just a quick snapshot of LinkedIn. So it's 18 years old. Happy birthday to LinkedIn this month. And it has changed over the last 18 years. And you could say has turned into quite a mature young adult. So from pronouns on the platform to stories and sophisticated ad targeting, LinkedIn is one of the best platforms for business targeting. So the strategic purpose to connect with people and to sell to them. And we are going to be talking about lead generation today. It has become a lot more accessible as well. So over the last 18 months, I would say this number keeps increasing. More and more people are coming to the platform to learn, to connect, to engage. And also there is a younger audience coming to the platform to share their thoughts. So the age has definitely become more diverse in people interacting. It is actually voted the number one platform as well for trust. And because of that, people are more likely and feel more comfortable to engage with ads because users feel LinkedIn are more likely to protect their privacy and data versus other social media platforms. So what I want to do now is just set the scene in terms of what lead gen is, just to ensure there's absolutely no confusion. So when we talk about lead gen, lead generation, it's the process of collecting data. So that could be email data, it could be companies, it could be a person's name, and it's so you can convert them into a lead. Whereas demand generation is more focused on employee advocacy. So it could be someone in your sales team nurturing a customer and interacting with them in that way. But today we're going to be focusing on predominantly lead generation. So LinkedIn has a bunch of solutions for lead generation. When we're thinking about targeting, we can reach people based on things like their job titles and where they work, their years of experience. We can also retarget people who have interacted with us on our website, or if we have any CRM data of users, we can re-engage and retarget them. And in terms of the different formats that exist, there is lots of different ways that you can engage audiences, whether that is an email or it could be a text ad. Or most commonly with lead gen, we have the lead gen forms feature. Now, I don't want to give too much away here because Lara will be going into this, but essentially it's a really great and easy way to capture leads. And it's a fantastic and really seamless experience for the user when they are looking to get content from a business, that value exchange. And when we think about reporting and optimization, if you have that pixel implemented on your site, you can gather insight around how many people have clicked on a link and converted, how many people have purchased, and you can get some real granular information around the demographics of those users too. Actually, one of my favorite features of LinkedIn. So if you look in the ads section of LinkedIn, and we're thinking about lead gen as an objective, it typically sits at the bottom of the funnel. And we have a responsibility as business owners to build brand awareness up until that point. And Lara will go into more details, but as you can see here, it's focused on conversion activity. And here's an example of what an ad build could look like. So if you wanted to run a lead form campaign on LinkedIn, you're going to set the objective to lead generation. So that's an instruction that you are giving LinkedIn to find people that are likely to interact with that content and give you their data. And you can target people. Here is an example based on job titles and then using the single image format, which would be a pre-LinkedIn filter form. So I'm going to pass over to Lara now to talk through some challenges. And also we're going to open up the poll section here too. And we would please ask you to engage in that poll.
Thank you, Kinetta. Yes, let's get some engagement going. The question in the poll was, what lead generation challenges are you facing as a marketer or as an agency? I can see some responses coming through. So some of you are saying prospects complete a form, but don't engage any further. Oh, we're switching a bit. Prospects open a form on LinkedIn or on your website, but they drop off without completing. Perhaps there's too many fields or they get distracted. Prospects complete a form, engage with sales, but they are not of the right quality in the long term. And those who have typed other, please use the chat. I'll be curious to see what the answer would be. In previous sessions, I heard of CPL. I think cost comes up as a big challenge and something that we're going to be addressing next. I'll give it 5 seconds. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Amanda, you are not using LinkedIn for lead gen yet. Hopefully you will after this session, and I'm about to end the poll and share the results. So we can see there's actually a quarter or a mix between prospects complete a form, but don't engage any further. So there's a disconnect between what marketing is trying to do and how they actually follow up with those leads. And prospect complete a form, engage with sales, but they're not of the right quality in the long term. And I'll be addressing some solutions to the challenges that you as a marketer or as an agency working with marketing face. Excellent. The first challenge, if we were to put it into a bucket, would be failing to own your brand. It's a known industry. According to LinkedIn research, only 4% of marketers measure beyond 6 months. Whilst 75% optimize inside 2 weeks. It's what the industry knows to be short-termism. We are measuring CPL for a campaign, and we are obliged to report on results for the short term. Perhaps there's a disconnect with what happens in the long term and how it falls through to sales pipeline. And this is especially worrying for B2B because some sales cycles will last much longer than 6 months. So it's something for us to address in our day-to-day roles and capacities. And anyone who has sat at a LinkedIn session, I'm thinking of Alexander joining us from Bangkok today, and anyone else that has watched us talk about the B2B Institute and the work that we have done with the IPA, the Institute of Practitioners in Advertising. And whether you are a client operating the B2C space or B2B, it's important for you to invest in both short-term, yes, lead gen is important, but brand, I would arguably say, and there's a lot of research to back that up, is even more important. And this is what the IPA suggests based on an analysis they have done on tons of case studies that they have received from their clients, so the IPA Case Studies Bank. They understood that customers that were reaching heavily and high return on investment were primarily focusing on brand building. So 6% of investment was dedicated to making sure that they were earning share of voice and therefore building their brand for the long term, whilst 40% of that budget was dedicated to lead gen. This is for B2C brands. The IPA and the B2B Institute, which is a think tank of LinkedIn, have got data for B2B, which is usually 50-50. But if you're thinking about consumer finance, the split is actually 8-20. And you can imagine why. 8% in brand investment, because you need to nurture audiences, gain their trust. So this is an important message, even though today's session is about lead generation. And just to finish it off with another data point from the IPA, is that, well, as we can see here, combining brand and lead gen efforts lead to 5 times higher conversion rates. So something for you to take into your next meeting or to make sure that your budgets are dedicated to both brand and demand and lead gen accordingly. The second challenge is engaging in the wrong way. We see this happen a lot at LinkedIn with our customers, where their conversion on their website or their lead gen form is asking too much information from our members. There's not a value being given. If I was to ask you, please feel free to put in the chat, why do you come to LinkedIn? Top answers tend to be to achieve my goals, to invest my time and become a better professional and grow in my personal life. So why you as a brand would you not be giving value to capture the attention of members who are not just spending time scrolling numbers, they are investing time in themselves. Asking too soon or asking for the wrong things. And last week, I came across this post from a CMO that I'm connected to, very plain language, and that I thought I'll bring it up today. It's important to build a reputation by doing good work, build a network by being a good person, build a brand by sharing good content, but ultimately be someone or be a brand, I might add, who always adds value, and there will always be value that comes back to you. So again, on LinkedIn, when you are asking for information, gating your content, think about the value you're really providing our members. Quantity over quality. This is a challenge that we see happen quite often. I can give you an anecdotal example. When I used to be an account manager a few years back, I had a client in the automotive industry, and they were running LinkedIn message ads targeted at different cities in the UK, sending members who completed their form onto a local dealership for test drives. Within the first week of the campaign, I remember the agency calling me to stop the campaign. They were doing so well, they had too many leads that they couldn't manage. Their dealerships didn't have the processing place to deal with those leads coming through. So this happens quite often, actually, where we think that quantity is important, and therefore we go for platforms where we have great scalability. But actually, you are also losing money if you're not addressing the leads and not driving the quality leads into conversion. So for the next 25 or so minutes, we are going to focus on how you can drive quality leads on LinkedIn. Of course, some of you might be interested to understand how you can own your brand. There is a course in our LinkedIn marketing online platform that I talked about earlier today, where you can learn more about it. And equally, if you want to understand more about content best practices, make sure to take our online course and certification when that comes through. driving quality leads on LinkedIn. Starting off with customer testimonials. You will be getting the slides. There's hyperlinks here. You can watch the videos at your own time. The first case study here is from Cindy Fan, shared a few years back. She was with VMware back then. And I summarized the learnings from the video. She talks about quality over quantity, looking at multiple metrics of success. Usually we use the vanity metrics that are available to us, such as CTR or CPL, but how can you use sales metrics? And I'm going to call out some of them in a short while. And finally, test. It is marketing, is a human science that we need to make sure we are being agile at testing what works for our audiences. And equally, the case study from B2 LinkedIn Hired, they talk about breaking up your audiences for testing purposes. And I quite like this quote. They say that CMOs might have a lower cost per lead, but they are harder to get hold later on by sales rep. So overall, the cost per qualified lead might be higher. So those are things that we all need to pay attention when we're trying to bring value back to our business. So let's deep dive into three factors to consider when driving quality leads on LinkedIn. Campaign qualification, some questions to consider. Again, apologies, there will be some words on the screen, but hopefully you are still with me and I'm communicating this in a way that you can understand and hopefully engage in a short while when we have the Q&A. The first question, how does your company define a sales conversion? This is important because you need to align on the metrics and communicate against the same objectives. How long is your sales cycle? We talked about the issue or the challenge that we have in our industry where we are measuring short term. And this is an important question if you are in the B2B space or in even high consideration B2C, where I'm not going to rush to buy a Tesla car. I will do a lot of research and maybe my thinking process and buying process could last 6 to 12 months. I actually had some friends looking for an electric car and it's been 3 months in the making. They still haven't decided. So yes, so this is something for us to really take into account. What does a quality lead mean to you? Again, what attributes do you want to prioritize, right? So is a CMO worth more than someone junior? Perhaps, most likely, yes. But ultimately, they're both important because they're part of the buying committee. Most likely the junior person will be responsible for collecting information and doing some of the groundwork, whilst the CMO might be the one sealing the decision and signing off the deal. And I would like to stop here to share another case study. And I left again the link on the slide, which you receive. When it comes to measuring the value of campaigns, we are not interested in vanity metrics like clicks and impressions. We are interested in monthly recurring revenue. This is an example of a metric that is managed by marketing, but is using the language of sales and revenue teams. This is from Casper. He is a customer of LinkedIn. He used to be with Templify when he shared this quote. And again, you can take a look at the case study to see how he implemented LinkedIn Legion campaigns in the Nordics. So these are some of the metrics that you can take into account when thinking about activating both brand and demand, but communicating campaign success, marketing success, and overall sales outcome. So for instance, success metrics when you are running your campaigns on LinkedIn or other platforms will of course be awareness and fame metrics, unique reach, sales activation metrics, if you're driving activation, form completion, CTR, etc. From a marketing standpoint, you need to establish yourself. Therefore, you need to understand whether your brand is well-perceived by your audience. How is it doing against your competitors through LinkedIn brand studies, which are coming on the platform very soon, brand lift studies. Stay tuned for that. And equally, from a Legion perspective, are you driving people to an event? I'm sure Jellyfish will be measuring that today. And finally, sales outcome. Are we turning them into monthly subscribers? Are they becoming an advocate of our brand? Are they driving quality in the long term? Those are the things that we should establish and agree within a business. Marketing automation. We would not be able to do everything manually. Some customers do opt to manage through Excel, but we are integrated with a bunch of partners. For instance, you can use Bombora to help you understand a little bit more about your buying committee. They use language such as surge. Are they in market, ready to convert and buy, or are they not on surge? Therefore, you might need to do a little bit more of groundworking to bring them down the funnel. Other technology partners that integrate with LinkedIn will help you manage your leads and nurture them further. So in Europe, we work a lot with Converter. Customers will be using them to help them cleanse their data to match their CRM and have a unified view across all platforms, or perhaps Marketo to help them nurture. And one case study or use case that we get a lot at LinkedIn is that customers might have their own CRM and they want to be able to integrate to LinkedIn. To become a LinkedIn partner, especially for lead gen, it takes a lot of work because of the due diligence that we need to do, seeing there's a lot of PII and data involved here. Therefore, we recommend you to work with a bridge. A bridge partner would be someone like Zapier. They're actually very low cost, entry cost barrier, and you can integrate your own CRM with Zapier and therefore integrate with LinkedIn and other platforms as well. So those are some examples for use cases with our marketing automation tools. And then the two last questions to ask. Number five, what's your sales team's lead response time? Of course, the longer your team takes to reach out, the less likely people will be to convert. And then finally, how are leads being nurtured? And there's a few ways you can nurture your leads on LinkedIn. We don't quite offer sequential messaging as yet, but we have launched retargeting based off engagement on the platform, which is a great way for you to bring people through the funnel. So just looking at retargeting, we actually offer two ways of retargeting. The first one is called website retargeting, and you need to have the insights tag, the LinkedIn pixel, implemented on your website to be able to track people that visit your site and then retarget them on LinkedIn. And then the second way to retarget is engagement retargeting. There's different ways you can do that. A couple of ways is based on paid engagement. So people that have watched the video, perhaps for 15 seconds, and you want to retarget them with another piece of content. Or perhaps people that have, as I have here on the screen, opened a lead gen form, but they haven't submitted. So it was one of the challenges that I call out earlier. People might open it, but they see the fields. They're not quite ready to give their details away. They'll close off and go away and carry on with their lives. This is a great way for you to retarget those audiences with a new campaign. Account targeting, account-based marketing. For instance, you have a list of audiences in certain markets that you need to nurture further. This is a great way for you to do it. You can upload, or of course, you can integrate with one of our partners, as I mentioned. We highly recommend you to use our templates. They're available online on Campaign Manager, or just search for it online. You will see that you have the option to put their name, the company name, the domain. We highly recommend you to put both because it will match against company pages on LinkedIn. On the slide that Kinetta had early on, it showed that we have over 57 million companies present on LinkedIn, from small businesses to medium to large. You can identify them and target their employees using account targeting. Contact targeting is email addresses, very sensitive data, hence why we recommend you to integrate with an automated tool to avoid any hiccups with GDPR. We only target members who have opted in, so we are fully compliant on that matter. And then finally, lookalike audience, very similar to other platforms. We identify an original audience that you select. Perhaps it is website retargeting that you want to find new audiences based on that original list. And you can report on that so you can see how it performs. And we usually see high perform of lookalike audiences because, of course, it's based off audiences that would have performed well in the past. We could spend at least an hour talking about account-based marketing. As a matter of fact, we have done that before, and I have left the link to the recording and our framework playbook for account-based marketing for you to download and share with your sales team and have perhaps a little workshop internally. We are now going to spend around 10 or so minutes talking about how you can capture your leads on LinkedIn. So this will be more product and feature focused. And then Kinetta will come back and share the inspirational example before we open up for Q&A. So thank you for being with us. Ways to capture leads, conversions on LinkedIn. They are used interchangeably. They mean the same thing. You want people's information, as Kinetta mentioned. You want their email address. You want to know who they are, their profession, so you can engage with them and potentially do business with them, right? So there's two ways you can do that on LinkedIn. Conversion tracking. Conversion tracking is when you are sending LinkedIn members to your website. You've got the LinkedIn Insights tag implemented, again, the pixel, and you are going to track whether they convert on that page or not. The conversion could be literally just landing on that page and spending some time. That could be a page conversion for you, or it could be a click to add to a cart and purchase something or download a webinar, white paper, etc. And then lead gen form, which is our most popular feature. It is a pop-up that would be attached to one of our ads. So you can integrate a lead gen form to sponsor content. And sponsor content comes in three formats. So the video format, the carousel ad, or the single static image. And you can also integrate a lead gen form to a sponsored messaging format. Website conversion tracking. This is an example of a LinkedIn conversion. You can see here, actually, if you land on a LinkedIn page, you've got the autofill. Autofill is also available if you want to implement on your website. Just use your help center to learn how you can do that, as long as you have access to a LinkedIn team. Why should you use conversion tracking with LinkedIn? I bet most of you, again, let's take a look at the chat. Most of you would be using Google, Omniture, Adobe, etc., to track your conversions. Why should you now implement the LinkedIn pixel to do the same? Because you get additional data and unique data that can take you to the next level of your campaign management. So for instance, at LinkedIn, we offer both post-view and post-click conversion tracking. So you have visibility of over people who have converted by seeing an ad post-view, as well as clicking on the ad. So the last click attribution, which is predominantly used by Google. We can also offer you different types of attributions, which takes into account multiple campaigns or just one campaign. And then finally, unlocks demographics. This is the power of LinkedIn. You can understand who converted from a job function, company size, industry, and optimize towards those. And one thing to call out, that insights tag, the pixel, unlocks additionally website retargeting, which I talked about, and website demographics. So if you Google search for the LinkedIn Insights tag, it has an explanation of what all that you can get from implementing that on your website. And I would say website demographics, which is free of charge, is a game changer, or has been a game changer for a lot of people. Hopefully to some of you on the call, drop in the chat if this is the case. Before we move on to lead gen, I am going to bring the elephant in the room. I was reticent about talking about this, but I'm sure the question will come up. So I'll try to preempt it and I'll, of course, address any further questions from this. So what's happening? What's LinkedIn doing with regards to Apple iOS 14.5 app tracking transparency framework changes? We like to put the whole name down. So marketers might notice a small decline in conversions due to a more restricted access to info shared across apps on Apple devices. This is ultimately what's happening. But why do we say that it's a small decline? There's a few reasons why. And I actually have taken notes because I want to make sure that I share all of this, the reasons to why that could be. So it will be only small because not every user can or will update their operating system on their phone. My mom being an example, she's got a very old iPhone. I don't think she's updating it very often. Secondly, adoption of iOS is not equal across the globe. US folks joining from New York, Baltimore, you will know that in the US, the market share of iOS is quite high, whereas in Europe, it's not the case. Third, the change impacts app only, not web browser. And then finally, This new update will enforce app developers to adopt to industry changes to make sure that they're getting the consent to use people's data. But not everybody is going to opt out. So all of that make it this a small impact to LinkedIn. We're not recommending anything for you to do with your campaigns, but if you'd like to take the time to test LinkedIn lead gen form, then this is a good time to do so. And just to finish it off, our first party data is second to none. So it's something that's not being affected by this particular change that's happening in our industry. Let's now talk about lead gen forms. And this is the final portion of my part in today's webinar. So hopefully we can soon hear from you as well. So as I mentioned earlier, you can use lead gen form with a sponsored content format or sponsored messaging. And as a matter of fact, according to researchers in the industry, and again, the link here for you, lead gen forms drive 5 times higher conversion than landing pages. And we can imagine why. We are on LinkedIn because we want to be on LinkedIn. We are very unlikely to be persuaded to go away through a landing page. That's why if the form pops up, it's much easier. Also, a lot of advertisers don't have the time and money and resources to create landing pages for conversions. So using a form is a great way to do it natively. What do you need to get started? So you need ad creative, as I said, sponsor content or sponsor messaging. You need to understand what your call to action will be. And then you need to create your lead gen form. This is the way you're going to be collecting members' information, and I'm going to be sharing more about it in a minute. And then a thank you page. Now, we have launched a template to make your lives easier. It contains the specs as well as an Excel form, especially if you're working, you are, let's say, a media agency working with a creative agency. It's a great for you way to share a common document where you are uploading the creatives, which will then be uploaded into Campaign Manager. So this is, again, a great asset for you to take advantage after today's call if you haven't seen it before. So just pay attention to what fields will pre-populate. Try to use the fields that are, again, pre-populated for you to save members' time, to try to drive a higher completion rate. So for instance, a member cannot submit a form with an empty section. So again, try to think about that when creating the form and asking for that information. Speak to your sales team. Don't over ask, right? So for instance, you might be asking for the email address, their telephone number, and their full name and position. Have the conversation with sales. Do they need their phone number if you have the email address? Or perhaps you might suggest that they collect their LinkedIn profile, where it has a lot more information for them to then qualify and do more of a sales warm approach. So just think about that, especially because some of the fields are quite sensitive. If you put yourself in the member shoes, I personally would not be giving my phone away to anyone. And actually in Europe, this is quite common. We have run a lot of campaigns, and in, for instance, the Nordics or in Germany, phone numbers just lead to dropout rates. So just be conscious of that. And again, A-B test, because in different markets, different cultures, people are more likely or less likely to give certain information away. Some of the quick tips for when creating your form. So first, pay attention to the offer headline. That is what jumps out when you are scrolling through LinkedIn. You need to catch the member's attention. What is in it for me if I stop to scroll through and pay attention to what you're saying? So make sure that you're giving that value right from the start. And then the offer details is where you're going to reiterate the value exchange. Give a little bit more of background into why you're asking for their information. Privacy policy. We move the privacy policy to the top. It is obligatory field. If you don't have that there, your form will be rejected. The privacy policy should also match the language of the ad. Again, another reason why a lot of lead gen forms get rejected. You need to communicate otherwise at the bottom a reason why the policy doesn't match the language. You might want to call that out in this privacy policy text, which is optional. And then the lead gen details and custom questions. Keep the number of questions to a minimum, less than 5 fields or fewer. We say 2 to 4 is a good range. And once again, think about if I open a form with a lot of questions, would I want to give that away? Is it worth my time for a webinar, a white paper to give my phone number? So balance that out and make custom questions easy to answer. If you need to use a custom question for lead qualifying data, then we suggest multiple choice rather than single line input, because again, it's free thinking. You need to think about how to answer, etc. And multiple choice is a great way for you to capture qualifying data. So again, automotive customers, they have used before to understand maybe what dealership would someone want to go and have a test drive at. You'll perhaps put a couple of options. Or maybe you want to use it to identify the earning brackets of that individual. So those are examples of ways you can collect qualitative data, but just be aware that could also affect your overall cost per lead because of dropout rates. And then finally, on the form, you have got your consent. This little tick box is where you can collect members' consent. We at LinkedIn are compliant to GDPR, but you as a business need to understand what else do you need to put in place to make sure that the data you take away from LinkedIn, which is compliant, is then managed correctly your end. Some clients do not need to have an opt-in at all, so they would not have this, hence why we make it optional or required. And some clients might need to have double opt-in. So again, just understand with your own legal team what's required and how is the data being managed, and use this field to explain that to our members. Even though we allow for 5 custom checkboxes, as you're going to guess, 1 or 2, ideally, less is more with exchanging value and communication. And then the final stage of the form creation is your confirmation page. What would happen here? A lot of time brands neglect this, but it's very important because if you are going to give access to a white paper there and then, make it clear. If they have to visit your website or if they need to wait for your salespeople to call them, again, have that information there. So it's visually aligned with the overall user journey. I've put a little bit more tips here. It's a cheat sheet. Take a screenshot now or use it later when we share the slides to share with the rest of your team or to share with your creative agencies creating the lead gen forms, and test. Have a couple of lead gen forms running concurrently to see what works best and continue that conversation with sales in terms of how are they managing the data once you give that to them. And then the final thing that I wanted to share will be about reporting, which means that we might have a little bit longer than 10 minutes for Q&A, even better. We'll give time back. We'll see. About reporting, there's some key metrics you can access from Campaign Manager. As you can see here, we call it key result. Key result on your Campaign Manager dashboard aligns to the objective you selected when you started creating your campaign. So it's very important to ensure that you select lead generation as an objective. Otherwise, you won't be able to unlock lead gen forms. So that's the only objective we offer for that. And then you can access metrics such as CTR, CPC, cost per result, lead gen form opens, and demographics. Demographics is maybe you can just about see it on the screen. You can select by job seniority, company size, industry, and then see who is the top engagers from, of course, an impression perspective, but most likely be interested in who's opening your forms, and finally, who is actually completing your forms and giving you data. So maybe you can optimize your campaigns using this demographic available to you. And then a final reminder to reiterate, work with a LinkedIn partner. Integrate, especially if you're already working with the big companies like Oracle, Marketo, make sure that integration is working. So you take the audiences from LinkedIn and nurture them further with campaigns in other platforms. So there's a seamless journey for your members. Hopefully that is a message to go through. And this is it for me. Over back to you, Kineta.
Thank you, Lara. I think you've taken most of the work there where I sit back and learn something. So thank you so much for that. So I really, really like these examples, and I would encourage you all to interact in this section, because we have a couple of minutes left here before we go into the Q&A. So the first example we're looking at here is an upper funnel example. So we call this brand building, emotionally connecting. So why do you think, team, looking at this example, it's by EDF, it's a really good one for upper funnel awareness activity? So in the chat bar, if you could plug in your thoughts. So why is this a good example by EDF for upper funnel engagement? Okay, so we've got it's a video. Absolutely. Videos are the best way to tell stories and emotionally connect. That's what brand building is all about. You can see here that EDF are not saying sign up, download, buy, request more info. It's absolutely, it's inspirational. It's that value exchange that Lara talked about. You're giving something back. It's interesting. It's entertaining, possibly. It's educational. So this is a really good example of what we like to call brand building activity. And we have got, I believe, I might be wrong here, but a link to a case study. Is that correct, Lara, or not in this instance? Oh, you're on mute.
Sorry, I turned the video on. You have to get, you're on mute in every call, right? Yeah. This is an inspirational example. So we don't have stats for how
they performed,
but we do have some case studies coming in a short while, or link to the case studies hub as well, Kenneth.
Yeah, I think definitely that'd be a good one that we can share with you afterwards. So if we could just go on to the second example. So this is what we call mid funnel. So you could say targeting people that have already interacted with you in some capacity. And the event format on LinkedIn is a really great way to do that. An example like this today, we're giving something back to you in exchange, possibly, for your data. And you can retarget people that interact with events on LinkedIn. So another way to nurture those leads and share them, for example, afterwards, maybe something more functional or more commercial. And then finally, we've got an example of a bottom funnel piece of activity. So this is retargeting people, for example, who attended the event, to sign up to a newsletter. And you can see here, people are more likely or more willing to sign up because you've already built that connection with them. You're more likely to get that quality lead that Lara's been talking about today. So when looking at the funnel and thinking about lead gen, always, always think, at the top of the funnel, I want to emotionally connect with my audiences. I need to give them something back that's going to add value to their lives. Whereas when we are thinking about the bottom funnel, we can be more rational. We can be more functional with our messaging because we've already interacted in some capacity. So there's less priming needed. So I really, really like these examples. And it's a great way that EDF has pulled people right the way through that funnel. So when we share the deck afterwards, we will link through to these case studies that Lara was talking about before. So we'll make sure that you all have access to it. But read around to see how all different types of businesses from different verticals are using lead gen in their marketing activity. So what we're going to do now, team, is move on to a Q&A. And as mentioned at the beginning, we are giving away Happy Friday. A couple of premiums. So we're going to get the marketing team to determine who they think has asked the most challenging or complex questions. But let's take this time now to answer any that have already come up. And also, if you have anything else you want to ask us, now is your time. So I'm going to go with the first question in the Q&A. I think it was one of the ones earlier on. and probably something that you can answer, Lara. So someone has said, it's Alexandra. I know that LinkedIn lead gen forms can be integrated with Zapier, but what about other automation solutions such as Integrately?
Thank you, Alexander. Yes. So can you hear me?
Yes.
Excellent. Perfect. Let's take this question. I haven't heard of Integrately. It could be on the pipeline. We are constantly considering new partners, so I can certainly follow up for you. I think you might have my email address from back in the day, so drop me a note. But actually, I'm working quite closely with our BD or business development team, so I can just quickly ask the question, have we heard of this platform? Or maybe I can get from you a use case, because usually to help us drive integrations, we need, you know, actual use cases. What brands are using it? How much are they using it to really help us quantify and qualify that ahead? Excellent.
There's quite a few questions in the chat bar. So I'm going to scroll up to where I believe they start.
I think with Angela Lee.
We've got one from Julius at 3:45. I don't know if that one comes before it.
Yes. I mean, what I can see here is Angela. But I mean, I'll take your questions and yeah, we can take from there.
Okay, cool. Yeah, because I think we've got a couple in Q&A and a couple in chat. So one of the ones in chat from Julia said, can you download your leads from Campaign Manager or integrate with your preferred marketing automation or CRM tool?
You can do both. Actually, I forgot to call that out. It was on the slide, but you can download leads for 90 days. For 90 days, they are available via Excel file download. The challenge that we see, and Julius, I'm not entirely sure whether you are an advertiser, brand, or an agency. A challenge for agencies is to actually get access to that data, because it's PII, and the preferred way would actually be to integrate. So then you can send the data seamlessly from LinkedIn onto a CRM automated system to be processed through protected hashed ways.
Thank you, Laura. And we have another question. Again, I'm going to just go through the chat and then we'll move on to the Q&A. Amanda's asked, we target schools. Do you have a strength in this area? I tend to think of LinkedIn as a B2B tool. Sorry, also B2C tool.
Schools, education is within our top three verticals at LinkedIn. So of course, technology, clients, finance, education is within the top, because we work a lot with universities, but more often than not nowadays with education providers, because as we know, education has changed over the years. You can consume content and learn via different ways. So I used to work with Google, and we used to target a lot school professors and teachers to onboard the Google learning and Google education products. So yes, we do work a lot with that particular sector. So hopefully, if you just go on Google actually and type LinkedIn in education, we have a hub, a website just for education. So take a look, Amanda.
That's awesome. Angela Lee, is there a way on the lead gen forms you can get a link to their public profile?
Yes. So this was a field that was released a couple of years back, where you can select, tick the LinkedIn profile, and that will auto-populate. That cannot be edited, of course, for obvious reasons. We wouldn't want someone to give someone else's profile away. So that's a auto-populated, non-editable field. And we see a lot of customers, as long as you have a way to manage, because you need to understand that by capturing the profiles, it still needs to be a lot of manual work done. You need to go to the profile to understand who they are, how do you want to communicate with them, etc. But that's available. Thanks for asking, Angela.
We've got Susie. If you have a B2B company, what three-step recommendation for the funnel process and integration with HubSpot would you suggest?
So with HubSpot is one of our main partners. We work a lot with them from an organic and paid perspective. I'm not entirely sure whether I have a three-step recommendation, but I think the main recommendation would be, if you have a rep at HubSpot, to start a conversation there, because the heavy lifting of the actual integration happens at their end rather than at LinkedIn's. They actually have an amazing education platform, which I've been working with them on. And there you will find three, five, as many steps as needed for that integration based on your use case. So that would be my main recommendation. Start at their education hub. Ideally, if you have a rep, have that conversation. So then you can integrate, have lift, and then the data will flow through from LinkedIn, from your campaigns that you activate.
And we've got one from Victor. What percentage of a brand's LinkedIn ads budget would you recommend be dedicated to upper funnel, mid and bottom funnel campaigns? Appreciate this would depend on the sector type of objective.
Yes, if we take the IPA recommendation, so the Institute of Practitioners in Advertising, they talk about the 60-40 rule. So if we take the 60% into brand building, and again, it will depend on the vertical. Let's just talk about generic B2C verticals. The B2B is 50-50, but let's stick to 60-40, 60% brand building, no doubt about it. Videos, education content, inspirational, humor, you know, thought leadership, all into that bucket. And then the remainder, 40, it will be your 40% demand, 40% lead gen. It could be a split. Another split that we see quite often is, 40%, 20%, 20%, that adds up the maths. Apologies, a Friday mathematical brain's not working. So 20-20, so 20 demand, 20 lead gen. But a lot of times what we see is 20% towards always on activation sales. So for instance, companies that have monthly, quarterly webinars, like we do at LinkedIn, we have budget dedicated to the always on activation campaigns. And then 20% will be the reminder, will be perhaps sales, new product launches, things that are more cyclical. They don't happen as often. So if you think about your content calendar, again, just to summarize, 6% will be into your brand campaigns. And I've got actually four templates that I can share with Jellyfish to attach to the follow-up. So 6% to your brand campaigns, 20% will be to your always-on activation, and then the other 20 will be for your launches, seasonality, and things that will happen as your business grows and need to capture demand and leads from customers. But yes, I can share more information. There's plenty we could talk about it, and there's a whole content team at LinkedIn that specializes and can educate you more on that particular area.
We've got another couple from Julius. Very active today, Julius. Can you run auto personalized email messages through LinkedIn itself?
Yes. So, I say yes. That's my interpretation of your question, Julius. Please make sure to add more once I've responded if it's didn't quite hit the spot. But if you run sponsored messaging or traditionally called email campaigns, marketing campaigns, I'd like to say with LinkedIn, you can add macros that help you personalize your message. For instance, you can say hi, macro name, hi, macro job title. So you can talk to the audience in a more personalized way. I'm actually doing a session in September, the way to go, on sponsored messaging, which talks about our two formats, message ads, used to be known as email, and conversation ads, which we launched last year. We can make sure to connect with me, Julius, and you will see that pop up when I start promoting it. But hopefully that answered your question.
Got a couple more minutes left. So Amanda, how many organizations percentage do you think get it absolutely right for brand through the funnel?
That's a figure up in the air. I think we can talk about our favorites, Kenetta. Maybe you and I, maybe share some of your favorite brands and I can do the same, that we can kind of, if you think about yourself, yes.
No, go first.
I've been talking a lot because it's mostly LinkedIn, so I think it's quite a subjective question. I'll let you go.
Okay. Well, I'm very much a brand person. I do a lot of talks on brands, so I probably am best fit to answer this. So on LinkedIn especially, and if you've attended any of my talks before, who I think do brand really well is BrewDog. I don't know how much they're spending, but the reason why I think they do brand really well is they use the platform and use their CEO to share thought leadership. And it's usually around topics that are culturally relevant. So sustainability, pollution, and they've helped build their brand, not just through marketing or PR activations, but through their CEO. So it's a little bit different to what we've talked about today from a lead gen point of view. But if you want a good example of who I think nails brand on LinkedIn, it's going to be BrewDog, and follow James Watt, the CEO, for inspiration.
Are you also a fan of the product?
I love BrewDog, absolutely. And I'm probably going to have one in about an hour.
look forward to that. I look forward to that. Yes, I agree with Kinetta. So BrewDog, I mean, they're brilliant. And there are a bunch of other brands that do branding well on LinkedIn. I would also Google top companies on LinkedIn, because branding is not necessarily just a marketing job, but there's also HR with employee advocacy. And every year we launch something called top companies, and we explain why they are the top companies, which usually touch all of the points, the multi-touch points that are necessary to build a brand. So how much are employees communicating? Your CEO, is he, you know, posting, engaging on the platform? Are your employees sharing? I mean, Microsoft, Satya Nadella is always posting. And so top companies, take a look and hopefully get inspired at companies that are doing well brand-wise on LinkedIn.
Okay, so I think that's kind of coming to the end of our session. In terms of, okay, we've got one more. I think we could squeeze it in. One more question. So I'm a startup. How do you think I should be using LinkedIn to generate leads?
Yeah, so as a startup, organic plays a huge part. And I would advise you to take advantage of the latest features on company page. So for instance, you can tailor your CTA to help you take leads, so your call to action on your page. You can also encourage your employees, even if you are a small business, you might have one or two people, to be active on the platform. I think putting the people to a brand, it helps. So the BrewDog CEO talking on the platform, we see a lot of more of that, employees taking a front stance. And there's a bunch of other things you can do from your company page. So make that the best way to generate content and drive the message out to your audiences. And then you can, of course, bring in paid at a later stage. Sales Navigator is another product of LinkedIn that helps you generate leads through the network that you have on the platform. There's also a guide, Benoit, but if you just, again, Google LinkedIn and small businesses, we have a hub that helps the small businesses. We are making huge investments to help small businesses unlock LinkedIn to help them grow. Hopefully you can find some information. If not, connect with me and I can share that directly.
Okay, marketing have selected their winners. So we have Julius and Amanda, who are going to be the lucky winners of the premiums. So what we will do is we'll connect with you afterwards and make sure we can get that sorted for you. But thank you all for participating today. And Lara, thank you for taking the bulk of that content. It's been really interesting. I've learned something new today as well. And I think that's the most important thing here. It's always about learning, because there's so many changes to the platform. There's so many new products, innovations. So just always keep on top of what is happening. But thank you, Lara.
Thank you.
Cheers, team. Have a good weekend, and we'll be in touch with those premiums.